Hello people. In this video we want to look at the hydatid cyst of liver. See, hydatid cyst can be in many places. Okay, we are looking at the one in the liver. Now here you can see the hydatid cyst in the liver, how it is there, right? It has endocyst which is inside and ectocyst which is outside. Okay, it's the layer. Endocyst is inside and then you have ectocyst. Then and outside it you have something called as the adventitia or the pericyst or pseudocyst. Basically, this adventitia, pericyst or pseudocyst is actually a part of the liver. It is the liver tissue which has got changed into this adventitia, pericyst or pseudocyst. So what you should understand is when you're trying to remove the hydatid cyst, you should not touch, try to remove the adventitia because it will start bleeding, isn't it? So the adventitia or pericyst or pseudocyst is coming from where? It's from the liver tissue itself. The ectocyst, endocyst is, you can say the hydatid cyst, you want to remove this. Now this endocyst is there, right? This endocyst makes the ectocyst, okay? It makes the ectocyst and inside also it makes the hydatid fluid. Anyways, don't worry guys, we are looking at the complete details. We just explained the photo to you. Anyways, look at this. What exactly is happening here? We are looking at this topic here, hydatid cyst of liver. Because of a parasite that is Echinococcus granulosis, which is transmitted by dogs to humans. So what will happen this, when you swallow the ova, not the worm actually, they're talking about the ova. When you swallow the ova, it will penetrate the gastric mucosa. So just understand this, okay? So now let us say this is your stomach. Okay. What are we actually looking at? We are looking at problem in liver, right? Somehow this hydatid cyst is sitting here in the liver. Now how did it actually happen? You swallowed this ova, not the worm. Remember, it's the tapeworm kind of a thing, right? Echinococcus. So you didn't swallow the worm. Actually, you swallowed the ova. The ova is coming here and it is penetrating the gastric mucosa. It is going into the retroperitoneal structures. Okay, then it will go through via the portal vein. And via the portal vein, it is reaching the liver. Are you getting it? So this is the way it enters, and it enters the liver. It enters many other places also. This is the classification of Hellman's, if you remember in your microbiology, parasitology. Here you can see cestodes. Under cestodes, you have this tissue cestodes, under which you have this Echinococcus, the dog tapeworm. Echinococcus, you should know, okay. The cestodes are like the flat, okay, that's why they are called as tapeworms, and they have some head, okay. They have head which carries suckers, and they have something called as scolex. The scolex word is important. Everywhere you will see the scolex. Anterior end of the tapeworm, okay, it will have suckers and hooks for attachment. That the scolex is important for you to understand. Here you can see this Echinococcus granulosis worm drawn, and here you can see the scolex, and it has hooks on top. Can you see that? This is the egg or the ova, you can say, and this is the hydatid cyst which you will find in the liver. So inside the hydatid cyst, you saw that there is ectocyst and endocyst. Yes, but inside the endocyst, you see what is there? Daughter cyst is there. Then there's some brood capsule is there here. Okay, it is kind of scary, not drawn well here. We'll show you a better diagram, mate. Is this any better for you? These are some hydrated sand. They are saying this is a daughter cyst. It's a brood capsule here, which is connected. This one is daughter cyst, they are saying. And there is a scolex here, shown inside that. Stalk for this brood capsule they have shown. Right, then you have the endocyst, ectocyst, and outside that you have the pericyst, that is the adventitia layer. This, according to our lab, it says hydrated. That is larva. Looks strange, right? And this one is labeled as hydatid cyst liver, though it doesn't look round at all. Can you see anything here? There seem to be something round here. Okay. This hydatid actually means dew drop or something. It's called as dew drop in Latin or something. That is the word hydatid. Otherwise, hydatid, you see this word in many places like hydatidiform mole and molar pregnancy, etc. Now let's go here. What did you see? How it will reach the liver you saw? Then you saw that there are layers. Adventitia layer, that is the pseudocyst, that the pericyst we told you. It is a fibrous layer. It is actually derived from the liver tissue. So you should not try to separate it during surgery. Here they have shown the life cycle of this Echinococcus. So dog, basically you get it from dog. Okay. Now let's go to ectocyst. Ectocyst, we told you it is also called as laminated membrane. Remember, ectocyst also is called as laminated membrane. This is important for you. Ectocyst is also called as laminated membrane. It actually is derived from endocyst. We told you endocyst is the germinal epithelium. It is going to produce the ectocyst and the hydrated fluid inside, right? Then inside this, what will be there in the endocyst? You will have those brood capsules, which will have those scolices, etc. Now, how will this appear? This will be clinical features. You can have a hydrated cyst in your liver, and it can be silent, asymptomatic it can be. But you can have some dragging pain in the upper abdomen because your liver will be a little large because of the hydrated cyst. The liver is large, it will have a smooth surface, but remember, it will have a smooth surface, very important point. it will have round borders and it will be non-tender. See, there is dragging pain, but if I touch there, there will be no pain for you, that's non-tender, okay? Whenever you do this percussion, three-finger method, when you are percussing on the middle finger, you can feel the thrill, fluid thrill because of this hydrated fluid. Because of that, you can feel a thrill in the other two fingers. This is called as the typical hydrated thrill. So this is a sign that you can try to elicit if you know that the person or suspect the person has hydrated cyst, okay? This hydrated cyst, what happens is, because now let us say this is the liver and here there's a hydrated cyst, and if it is superficial, a minor trauma can cause a rupture of this, okay, and they can go into an anaphylactic shock. A minor trauma can become an emergency for them, okay, severe abdominal pain following minor trauma. So investigations for what these people you can do ultrasound, it will detect the cyst, okay. And you can also use this ultrasound to localize the cyst and aspirate it also. So that is a kind of a treatment also you can do for this hydrated cyst. Okay, we'll come to this. It's called as PAIR. So puncture, aspirate, etc. We'll come to that. Then coming to, you can find out whether the cyst is an active or inactive. Okay, so active group or inactive group. Inactive means it is degenerated, it's calcified. You don't have to do anything for this, okay, if it is degenerated or calcified. Active means it is fertile, it is large, okay, it is basically not shrinking kind of a thing. Then you can do abdomen x-ray. In select cases only you may need CT scan. You can know if it is superficial. If it is superficial, you will have to operate because it can rupture like we told you and cause anaphylaxis. ERCP is endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography, okay. So basically you are doing some endoscopic check. You can check if there is obstructive jaundice, you can do this. And they are talking about some treatment also. Cassoni's intradermal test. This is nothing but like your Mantos test. Intradermal, you will inject the hydrated fluid and check the hypersensitivity for the person. This is no longer used. Okay. So basically intradermal injections of this hydrated fluid to check the hypersensitivity. And then ELISA, etc. You can check for the worm, all that. You can check the antibody, antigen, etc. Now coming to the treatment, guys. So we told you if it is a dead cyst, then you don't have to do anything. You can leave it alone. If it is symptomless or if it is small also, it can be left alone. They are saying that. But if it is symptomatic or if the size is more, then you have to treat it. How will you treat it? You can give albendazole, which is nothing but these worms killer, right? Killing the worms. So you can, but the treatment is for 21 days. So 3 weeks of albendazole, and that too twice daily of 400 mg you have to give, okay? In between these, you'll have to give this 21 days, then take a break for 2 weeks, then again 21 days, again 21 days after a break of 2 weeks. So this is written here. See, maximum of 3 such cycles you have to give. Okay, you'll have to watch for neutropenia during this treatment. This is medical. Medical, what will you do? For hydrated cyst, what is the medical treatment, guys? Hydrated cyst of liver, medical treatment, come on. Albendazole, very good. Now let us go to surgery. Oh wait, there's one table here which is indicating why you should do medical treatment or not surgical. If it is inaccessible for surgery, if the patient is unfit for surgery, okay, if there is a contamination of peritoneal cavity at surgery, if there is a disseminated hydrated cyst, right? Disseminated means kind of all over the place, is it? That time you will go for medical. Now medical is not working, next you will go for surgery, isn't it? So what surgery you will do for these people? When will you do surgery? If the person is having symptoms, right? Or if the cyst is greater than 5 cm, or if it is non-calcified, that means it's active, right? If it is an infected cyst, all this you'll have to do surgery. Now, what surgery you can do? You'll do laparotomy and you'll isolate the cyst, okay? So basically, you're going to the liver, you're going to aspirate the contents of the cyst, then you're going to inject some scolicidal agents like Savlon or hypertonic saline. So you remove the content of the cyst, then you put some Savlon hypertonic saline, then you will, main thing we told you have to remove the ectocyst, endocyst, right? You'll have to remove those layers. You should not touch that, you should not pull out the adventitia, otherwise what will happen, that person will bleed. So you'll peel off the laminated membrane, you will adventitia layer should not be removed, otherwise it will bleed. Right now, all of the laminated membrane, the endosis, that is, both are same, right? They have to be removed. That's all. You understood, guys? That is laparotomy and isolation of the cyst. Basically, you're trying to remove the cyst. Now, here, before the surgery of such surgery, you should have given albendazole and hydrocortisone, because in case this ruptures, right, or if this hydrated fluid is leaking, what will happen? There can be anaphylactic reaction. So, you should give steroids also before doing the surgery. What surgery? Isolation of the cyst. Then what are the other surgical procedures you can do? Percutaneous drainage, you can go via the skin and without looking inside with the laparotomy and all that, you can do a percutaneous drainage. But they are saying that you should do with CT or ultrasound guidance. This is something, a different type of guidance, okay? Again, with all the emergency drugs, all the equipment or precautions you should do, okay? Now let us go here. This is also called as, because it's percutaneous, same pair, okay? You're puncturing, you're aspirating, you're injecting and re-aspirating, okay? Very similar to laparotomy, but here you're using ultrasound guided or CT guided. So basically you're just via the skin going, puncturing it, aspirating it and injecting probably the same thing, saline and hypertonic solution, and then you're re-aspirating, okay? So when will you do this percutaneous? Percutaneous, I'm thinking it should be more superficial, right? Then only you can do a percutaneous. What do you say? Superficial, if it is, you can do. Then if it is an uncomplicated cyst, we'll remember like this, uncomplicated, easy ones, poor surgical candidate, you cannot surgically do things. So if they have had multiple abdominal surgeries, there'll be a lot of adhesions, I'm thinking. Relapse following surgery means you just go via the skin, make an in-skin incision and try to drain it, okay? No need to go into surgery, laparotomy, go inside, etc. Okay, then coming to contraindications to pair, when will you do this? See, multiple septal. See, here they said unilocular, it's there, you do. If it is multiple septal, don't do. And if there are some communicating cysts, if there are dead and inactive cysts, obviously you don't have to do anything. Laparoscopic approach for these procedures are being done. If you're doing laparoscopic approach, then no need to go and again do a pair. Okay, no need to go via the skin directly to the cyst. Complications of hydrated cyst, guys. What can happen because of hydrated cyst? So we are done with the treatment, is it? Oh, nice. Okay, so that was the only surgery. Only two surgeries, they said. One is that laparotomy and isolation of cyst. The other one is this pair, puncture, aspiration, injection, re-aspiration, that is percutaneous. Okay. Here you can see some other surgeries that they have written here. Excision, that's what they told you. Then cystopericystectomy. What is this? So basically cystectomy I can understand, but this is just removing the cyst. Pericystectomy. Pericyst is your adventitial layer, right? Pericystectomy, okay. This results in excessive bleeding, but it will remove the cyst completely, okay. Capitonage, what is capitonage? If omentum is not available for closing the cavity, redundant cyst wall can be infolded into the cyst cavity and sutured. Hepatic resection, so I'm thinking they're removing part of liver itself, hepatic resection. Okay, look at this. Colloidal agents, what and all we told you? We told you about Savlon, isn't it? And what the side effects of each of this also they are writing. Okay, sodium hypochlorite, obviously you give sodium, you will become cause hypernatremia. Hypertolic saline, you will give saline and sodium chloride, hypernatremia. Easy. Okay. Now finally, what will happen if the hydrated cyst is there and you are not treating? The cyst can rupture, then there can be anaphylactic shock, this we already told you. Where are we here? The rupture can result in implantation of active cyst within the peritoneal cavity and growth. So it will rupture and it will grow elsewhere, looks like. Okay. So through the diaphragm, if it ruptures, empyema. What is that empyema? Collection of the pus in the cavity. Okay, lungs. Okay, then you have jaundice can become because of the obstruction. This sounds more like an obstruction to me. Large cyst compressing the biliary ducts. Suppuration, that is more like pus, is it? But this is rare. Calcification can happen, but if it calcifies, it's good for us, right? There's yet another organism which can cause this, multilocularis. So it, as the name suggests, it is having multiple locules, so you can't do a simple drainage, aspiration, etc. So this is causing malignant hydrated disease, which is a misnomer. But remember, it is difficult to treat, okay? So if they give you hydatid cyst of the liver, remember to say Icanococcus granulosus cestode, okay? It's a cestode. Do not forget to write that. Cestode means what? It's a helminth. Cestode. It's a helminth. That's it for now, guys, in hydatid cyst of liver, okay? Bye-bye.